The title of this panel is Race and Gender in Mormon Studies, Contemporary Perspectives. And tonight's session is designed to explore contemporary scholarship in Mormon studies related to, as the title suggests, race and gender. Both issues have played a momentous role among the Latter-day Saints, and scholarship on both race and gender in this tradition continues to expand and deepen in the Academy. This evening's session features two of the University of Utah's finest professors working in these areas. And those of you who know the field of study know how true that is. Margaret Toscano and Paul Reeve. Margaret will be speaking to us first. She is Associate Professor of Classics and Comparative Literary and Cultural Studies here at the University of Utah. She is the author of Strangers in Paradox, Explorations in Mormon Theology, and co-editor of Hell and Its Afterlife, a very interesting collection of essays that emerged out of a symposium that she co-hosted here at the University of Utah in what year?
I think it was 2006.
Yeah, I think that's right, 2006. And I had the pleasure of participating in the symposium and publishing in that volume. It was a real treat. Margaret, of course, is well known for her work in Mormon feminist thought and has published numerous articles and book contributions on this topic and others related to gender studies in religion. These include the Mormon Ordained Women Movement, The Virtue of Virtual Activism, and the forthcoming critical response to the LDS Church essay, Joseph Smith's Teachings About Priesthood, Temple, and Women, among many others. So thank you, Margaret. Pleasure to have you here. Our second speaker will be Paul Reeve, who is professor and director of graduate studies in the Department of History here at the University of Utah. He is the author of Religion of a Different Color, Race and the Mormon Struggle for Whiteness, for which he received, and here we go with the accolades and awards, the Best Book Award from the Mormon History Association, the Smith Pettit Best Book Award from the John Whitmer Association, and the Francis Armstrong Madsen Best Book Award from the Utah State Historical Society. So a clean sweep for Paul Reeve. Congratulations, Paul, on that fine work. He is also the co-editor of Mormonism, a Historical Encyclopedia, and co-editor of Between Pulpit and Pew, The Supernatural World in Mormon History and Folklore. At this point, we also want to pass along our thanks and well wishes to Ignacio Garcia, who was not able to join us this evening, and we wish him well. We will first hear from Margaret and then from Paul. Each will speak for approximately 15 to 20 minutes, followed by probing, engaging, and hopefully short questions from the audience. So please join me in welcoming Margaret Toscano.
Am I going to be heard here? Do I need to hold the hand mic, or am I okay? I could do that. Well, hopefully you can see that. You never know with the lighting how that's going to go. Again, it's a pleasure to be with you tonight. And I am going to be talking about, if I can get this thing to stop, about gender and Mormon studies. So I've entitled this Gender in Mormon Studies, Contemporary Perspectives, and connecting it to the Intellectual Life of Mormonism theme for this whole semester. Okay, so the question that I want to begin with tonight are, what are the contemporary issues in Mormon gender studies? Brian asked me to focus especially on what conversations are looking like right now. Okay, well, so what are the contemporary issues? And this was supposed to be kind of like a funny joke, where the first thing was, it's the same old, right? That it seems like when we're talking about gender issues, that the same issues come up over and over again. There's always the issue of women having voice and institutional power and how that can be brought about. There's also the issue of moving away from traditional gender roles, and how do we do that? And of course, why do we have these same issues that come up over and over again? And I think the answer is very simple, because we have a conservative LDS organization and that is very entrenched in certain discourses and structures of power. So the next question is, can we move away from the sort of same discussions that we seem to have about gender that come up over and over again? Is it possible to move away from those? And what can we do that will make a difference? Now, because tonight we're focusing more on Mormon studies than the intellectual tradition, I want to talk about some contemporary things that are happening. But even so, I think it's important to see what is sort of visible out there as well. Two of the terms that come up a lot with gender studies in Mormonism and looking at gender issues are issues of agency and activism. Will it matter if Mormon women do activist things to try to push both an agenda forward and to push the discourse forward? And so I think you could probably agree that one of the most visible signs of this right now is the Ordained Women Movement, which was started in 2013 with a very specific goal of getting women ordained within the LDS Church. Now, the approach that has been used by ordained women is to say the women in this movement are faithful, they're active LDS women, and yet they would like to see some changes in gender structures. And so although it started out with this goal of, you know, being bold and yet trying to stay within the tradition of Mormonism, very early on it was perceived as radical. And many of you probably also know that one of the founders, Kate Kelly, that you see, let's see if at least my little thing will work. Here's Kate Kelly. This was at one of our first actions in 2013. That she was excommunicated in 2014. And that very quickly did damage to the organization and the goals, raising the question of whether or not you could have a movement that was so bold in its goals and yet was trying to claim a real connection to the roots of Mormonism. But in spite of the fact that Kate was excommunicated and there was a lot of upheaval in the organization, it has continued. So the other picture that you see here is Brindis Roberts, and she is the current president of the Ordained Women Movement of the board, I should say. And they are continuing to do actions, but they are not as visible as they once were. And so the question is raised, you know, is there going to be any movement in this whole thing? Now, I want to juxtapose this picture, which is maybe on one side of the spectrum of the visible pictures that we have of what's happening with gender in Mormonism right now, where you have women who are saying, you know, unless we can see this quote from Brindis, maybe you can't read it. She says, let us walk boldly into a future where LDS women reclaim the spiritual authority and power exercised by our sisters in the past, where they all have achieved equality with faith with their brothers. And so we have, you know, that really bold statement, even though the movement has become less visible. And then I want to juxtapose that with this picture of Nyland McBain, who has taken sort of an opposite approach of working very much within the system. She has worked for the church with her production company. In 2010, she did a whole series of interviews with Mormon women. In 2014, she published this book, Women at Church, Magnifying LDS Women's Local Impact, and her whole approach there is that, look, I'm not going to talk about priesthood. I don't want to try to change the structure of the church. What I'm interested in is looking about at how women can make a difference in the local communities. And so she's claiming that women have a lot of freedom in that context to make a difference and to bring about changes. So we have, on the one hand, women that are saying, well, really, unless there's ordination, you're not going to see significant differences. And then women like Nylon who say, well, we can make a difference on the other hand. So I wanted to put these two images out there. And by the way, they're the only two pictures I have in my PowerPoint. So it might get a little dull from here. But I wanted to have those visual images because those are very strong images of kind of what the issues are that we're facing as Mormon women. But then I want to juxtapose or compare that with looking at some things that are happening in Mormon scholarship. And of course, the easiest way for me to do this is to talk about two things that I have been involved in. And so what I want to now say is that even though a lot of the issues are the same, women in priesthood, the ordination of women has been a major issue of gender studies discussion since the 1970s. But in spite of the fact that the same issues are there, we're still fighting the same battles, that really there are new contexts in which these things are being discussed. And those contexts are very important. So I think they have expanded in these new directions. And I have two reasons, I think, why this has happened. The first one is what some of you who are in academia know, that it's called intersectional feminism. And this is going to relate very much to what Paul's going to talk about, that in current feminist discourse, there's a lot of talk about how feminist issues overlap, intersect with issues of race and sexuality, LGBTQI issues, class, all of those isms that we're looking at in a university scholarly context. How do feminist women's issues overlap? And so right now, even though this is just a beginning area in Mormonism, it is a very important area for women talking about how these things overlap. The other issue is that I really think it's because of the internet and information that is now on the internet that we didn't have before that has changed some of the discussions. That really the digital age, the internet age, has changed how we have discussions. Certainly this is true with all the blogs that we see about gender issues. I mean, starting in 2004 with Feminist Mormon Housewives, which is one of the most visible. And there are many other Mormon blogs out there. Mormons like to talk. There are lots of blogs. And that has also changed what is happening. So I want to, for the rest of my time, I want to talk about two examples that deal with both of these, intersectional feminism and information on the internet, by talking about two projects that I'm involved in that hopefully will lead to some publications. The first one is one that Brian already mentioned. Many of you may be familiar with the fact that the LDS Church put up on their website, lds.org, a series of essays in response to information that is now readily available on the internet. There's one on race, of course. There's one on polygamy. There's one on becoming like God. There's one on Heavenly Mother. There are many different ones that respond, the Book of Abraham, that respond to some of the controversial areas of Mormon studies. And I was asked to participate in an edited volume with two editors, Matthew Harris and Neil Brinkhurst. Some of you may know them. And what they want to do, or what they're doing in this volume, is they chose scholars for these areas who are responding to what the church says on their website on these topics. So I was asked to respond to the one on Joseph Smith's teachings on priesthood, the temple, and women. And this book, which is in the process right now, supposedly, I think I'm right on this, that the University of Utah has agreed to publish this. So let me just quickly say a little bit about what's in that piece. So it's interesting that the church essay came out on Joseph Smith, Women, and the Temple, came out very close to the time that Ordained Women made its appearance. And so was it a response to the Ordained Women movement? It's very likely that it was. I also think that it could be a response to the Joseph Smith papers. That with the Joseph Smith papers now available very easily to anybody who knows about them and looks them up, you can see a whole different view of the Relief Society and Joseph Smith that perhaps people were not familiar with in terms of their regular church service. This to me is very fascinating because on the one hand, I know with my own experience that I have been writing about issues of priesthood for 30 years, and in interacting with church leaders, I was told over and over again, well, it doesn't matter what Joseph Smith said, you know, what are the current leaders saying? And yet the Joseph Smith papers and his statements about women and priesthood and the temple have obviously made an impact. And so this to me is a really interesting question. Do the historical issues matter, especially in a church that claims that it's the revelation of the current prophet that matters the most? And, you know, again, does it matter what Joseph Smith says about any of this? So let me just quickly, for those of you who may not know, I'm going to go through this as quickly as I can, but just a few of the statements that are on the Joseph Smith paper that come from the Nauvoo Relief Society minutes of 1842. For a member who's not familiar with this material, I mean, I myself began to see these documents clear back in the 1970s and 80s, but for most members, they wouldn't be aware of these until maybe they looked at the Joseph Smith papers online. So for example, these are quotes. He said that women would come in possession of the privileges, blessings, and gifts of the priesthood. Now obviously we have interpretation here that comes into play. I mean, in this essay, the writers of the church essay are going to interpret these statements in one way, and I have interpreted them in another way. And yet still, there's an argument, there is, you know, reasonable people could disagree on this. So here's another one. He said to the Relief Society he was going to make them a kingdom of priests as in Enoch's day, as in Paul's day. Or he said that the women should move according to the ancient priesthood. And finally, he told the Relief Society that the keys of the kingdom were about to be given to the women as well as to the elders. And those of you that know about Mormon theology, the term keys is very important in terms of priesthood authority. So in the church essay, they quote a few of these things, starting with the idea that because people are now aware of these statements, they want to make sure that a proper understanding and context for Joseph Smith's statements should be found. And bottom line for their interpretation, they say that basically what Joseph Smith intended by these statements is exactly what we see in the church today. And so here's a statement. Joseph's actions, this is a quote from the church essay, Joseph's actions illuminate the meaning of his words. Neither Joseph Smith nor any person acting on his behalf, nor any of his successors conferred the Aaronic or Melchizedek priesthood on women or ordained women to priesthood office. And so they say that, you know, you can be assured that this, you know, even though they start out by saying when people read these Nauvoo minutes, they're going to be astonished that Joseph Smith used all of this priesthood language to talk about women. But really, they say, this just means that he was using the terminology differently than we do today, and we can be assured that the way that the current leaders are interpreting this is the correct way, that we and so it's really trying to connect a line from Joseph Smith to the current day, which I think is interesting, that they're not trying to separate, but see that there's a line there. Now, I'm just going to quickly go through my response, and again, I mean, really, if I were going to make my argument, I'd have to do a lot more. My essay, obviously, is a lot longer, but just to summarize what I do in my response to the church's essay is to go back and look at more statements and more evidence to contextualize these statements of Joseph Smith, trying to show that indeed I think there's a possibility that you can interpret his statements to mean that he indeed intended to give women real priesthood, that it wasn't simply what the church essay calls only sort of this temple priesthood that has to do with marriage and sealings. So really the crux of the question is, were these promises of Joseph Smith to women real promises about priesthood, or did they just have to do with sort of temple sealings and the afterlife and the patriarchal family? I argue that if you look at this larger context, that he had promised the Relief Society that he was going to organize the women according to the pattern of the priesthood. So I bring in other arguments here. And really the second point I make is really the crux of the issue. The issue is whether or not the fullness of the Melchizedek priesthood as revealed in the temple is connected to the church priesthood. The church essay says no, I say yes, right? So that's really the argument. I'm sure I haven't given you enough to convince anybody, but that's okay at this point, right? And then we have two things that I say, well, Joseph did some stuff besides kind of these words. It's not just his words, it's what he did. That Emma Smith was anointed to the fullness of the priesthood along with Joseph Smith, and they were both ordained to be co-presidents of the Holy Quorum of the Anointed, and that there's evidence that Joseph Smith saw this quorum as an actual priesthood quorum. So, I mean, here we have scholars arguing me against, you know, the church scholars, although I'm not sure they're going to engage with me, right? But arguing, you know, how do we interpret this evidence? But my important point here is that because of these documents that are now online, the church feels a responsibility to respond to that, and that then brings scholars back into the conversation, which I think then enlivens the whole discussion again. And so in addition to activism like ordained women, we have these scholarly discussions about how do we interpret Mormon history and doctrine. The second issue has to do with the Heavenly Mother. So once again, I mean, I've been writing and speaking about both priesthood and Heavenly Mother since the 1980s. And yet this issue has come alive once again, and really it's because of intersectional feminism that and issues of race, issues of, you know, sexual orientation and so forth. So recently, just in August of 2016, a scholar by the name of Taylor Petrie published an article in the Harvard Theological Review. It's called Rethinking Mormonism's Heavenly Mother. In this article, this is a quote from him. He says, Mormon feminists writing about Heavenly Mother have been complicit in heteronormative narratives that universalize a subset of women as the hypostasis of woman. So for those of you who are not experts in gender studies, what the hell is he talking about, right? Basically what he's saying is that the concept of Heavenly Mother, if you have God the Father and God the Mother that are married as this married couple, then the ideal in Mormonism becomes the heterosexual couple. Where does this leave LGBTQ people? And in addition, he says, well, if you have this one image of a Heavenly Mother and she's sort of this white woman, right, then what does this say for all the diversity of women in the world? How do we deal with that? And of course, in his article, he lists me and Janice Allred and Valerie Hudson Kessler as the culprits in this heteronormative battle. And so this has led to me wanting to do a new project where I respond to this, which I think is, these are very important questions, theologically, that have very practical issues to them. So not long after the article came out, Taylor invited me, and actually he and I have had some very friendly discussions. We're gonna even have, I think, a panel of SMPT, Brian, but to do an online blog on, by common consent, if any of you know about that, to talk about this issue. And so we got into a lively discussion, and so just to quickly go through my arguments, I say, look, if you really look at all my writings, I have a lot of exploration about looking at Heavenly Mother in diverse ways. I think more than maybe, well, I can say, if I think that he's right, if you're thinking about sort of what the church portrays as the ideal, like in the Proclamation of the Family, there's very much this picture that Taylor talks about as a problem. But I argue that my writing is a little more complex, obviously, than that. And that I've dealt with different pictures of the female God, maybe even a female trinity within Mormonism. And I argue I've never said that I believe in any kind of strict gender roles, and that I think people are capable of many sexualities and qualities and so forth. So really, this is a hard question, and I think what I want to emphasize here is how exciting it gets. Because even though on one level you could say, well, the Heavenly Mother, this is an old topic, but as soon as we start talking about theologically, what are the implications of a Heavenly Mother, where are we going to go? And of course, the answer that you get in a lot of traditions is simply that you say, well, we believe in a God that's beyond gender, you know. God is not embodied, God does not have gender, God is not like that. But Mormonism and Mormon theology has the real problem of having an embodied God, and that's very much a part. And so from my perspective, it doesn't help simply to go that direction in Mormon theology. You've got to think of more creative ways of doing it. Mormonism embodiment is a big deal. One of my little snide comments to Taylor and all of this, and here's my quote, where I say, look, and I'm just paraphrasing my own writing here, I say, look, eliminating the Heavenly Mother does not eliminate the problem of how we deal with heterosexuality and homosexuality and all these things. Mormonism is already entrenched in with this very male Godhead and this very patriarchal system. And that really, if you eliminate the Heavenly Mother, all you've done is eliminate a female image of God. So that's sort of the direction I take that. So this is going to be my paper I'm working on, The Gender of God and the Diversity of Human Sexuality. And I'm really looking at what are the possibilities within Mormon theology. And I have to say that one of the things I like about Mormon theology is that it is very expansive, that there are a lot of possibilities for exploring. For example, from my perspective, I think the Mormon notion of a council of gods, of an Elohim, is a possible way of working through some of these Godhead problems. And we could talk about race, but I'm out of time. So this is my sort of conclusion, and what I've tried to demonstrate tonight is that we have these gender issues that don't seem to go away, but we have new contexts for thinking about these things in exciting new ways. And I think that the Mormon intellectual life offers a lot of possibilities for thinking and discussing that hopefully can move us into some productive directions. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Is it moving? It didn't like me, and it's my machine.
Well, thank you to Brian for the invitation, and it's an honor to be on this panel with Margaret. In the months leading up to the 2012 presidential election between Barack Obama and Mitt Romney, a few media outlets reinforced the public perception that Mormons, or members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, were mostly white. Jimmy Kimmel asked on Jimmy Kimmel Live, "Are there black Mormons? I find that hard to believe." Reporter Jessica Williams from Jon Stewart's The Daily Show interviewed 5 black Mormons and then called them mythical creatures, the unicorns of politics. She asked if the 5 that she met comprised the entire population of black people in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Susan Solony, a reporter for the New York Times, similarly speculated in a Times online video that there were only a very small number of black Mormons, a couple of thousand max, or somewhere between 500 and 2,000. All 3 broadcasts revealed a public perception problem for Mormons in the 21st century, that they are too white. The irony lies in the historical evolution of that public perception. Black saints were among the first to arrive in the Salt Lake Valley in 1847 and have been a part of the Mormon experience from its beginnings. The first documented black person to join this American-born faith was Black Pete, a former slave who was baptized in 1830 when the fledgling movement was less than a year old. Other blacks trickled in over the course of the 19th century and are woven into the Mormon experience. At least 2 black men were ordained to the faith's highest priesthood in its first 2 decades. Yet by the beginning of the 20th century, Mormons themselves had erased black pioneers from their collective memory and solidified race-based priesthood and temple restrictions in their stead. On the inside and on the outside, black Mormons were lost to history. So when Brian asked me to survey the contemporary state of the subfield of race and Mormonism, I thought of 3 ideas around which I could organize my thoughts. The first is the way in which historical forgetfulness has shaped the field and been the dominating feature in the historiography. The second is the power of whiteness in Mormon history and in US history and the need to grapple with that fact in the historiography. And the third is the gap between the academic scholarship and the LDS curriculum, or the way in which race is taught within Mormonism. So we will go with the historical forgetfulness first. And just to illustrate what I mean by historical forgetfulness, I'm just going to drop us into a moment in Mormon history. So one of the black priesthood holders in the 19th century was a man by the name of Elijah Abel. He was ordained as an elder in March of 1836, and then as a member of the Third Quorum of 70, which was a missionary unit in the 19th century, in December of that same year. These ordinations were sanctioned by Joseph Smith. He received the initial temple ritual in Kirtland, Ohio, was not in Nauvoo when the rest of the temple ceremony was introduced by Joseph Smith. He appeals for the rest of those temple rituals in Utah. In 1879, he appeals to John Taylor, who was then the leader of Mormonism, and this produces an investigation. Joseph F. Smith, who is then an apostle, is sent to interview Elijah Abel, and Abel, according to Joseph F. Smith, produces his certificates and verifies his status as a black man and a priesthood holder. Joseph F. Smith then returns back to this meeting and defends Abel's priesthood as valid as a result of having interviewed Abel firsthand. What we see then taking place in Joseph F. Smith himself, and remember Joseph F. Smith then is the leader of Mormonism from 1901 to 1918, is a slippage on what Elijah Abel actually means for Mormonism. So this is the historical forgetfulness. Joseph F. Smith himself is a part of this misremembering that takes place. So in 1895, and another meeting that the LDS hierarchy is investigating racial matters, Joseph F. Smith defends Abel as ordained to the priesthood and reminds those who are gathered that he was ordained at Kirtland under the direction of the prophet Joseph Smith. Then in 1904, the slippage starts. In 1904, Joseph F. Smith calls Abel's ordination a mistake that was never corrected. And in 1908, he claimed that Abel's priesthood ordination was declared null and void by the prophet himself, meaning Joseph Smith. And so that process of historical forgetfulness will place this priesthood restriction, its origins with Joseph Smith. It was there from the beginning. Joseph Smith put it in place and is in fact of divine origins. Okay, so that's this process of forgetfulness. In that same 1908 meeting then, Joseph F. Smith decides that missionaries, quote, should not take the initiative in proselyting among the Negro people, but if Negroes or people tainted with Negro blood apply for baptism themselves, they might be admitted to church membership in the understanding that nothing further can be done for them. So proselyting efforts are curtailed amongst black populations in the U.S., and so once those two pieces are in place, you are erasing from collective Mormon memory the black priesthood holders that complicate the racial story, suggesting that priesthood has always been white, it's been white from the beginning, it will take a revelation to get rid of it, and in fact it does take a revelation 70 years later. But you're also ensuring that Mormonism for the 20th century becomes known as a white church because you're curtailing your missionary efforts amongst the black population. So that's what I mean when I say that historical forgetfulness is an important part of this story and helps to shape the way in which the histories of race and Mormonism have been conducted. And so then historians are the ones who begin to remember the black priesthood holders and begin to complicate this story of this whiteness that had been in place from the beginning. And that starts to take place in the 1970s. A couple of influential publications, Steve Taggart's Mormonism's Negro Policy, published in 1970 by University of Utah Press. And then much more influential is Lester Bush's publication in Dialogue, a Journal of Mormon Thought. So Bush's article is important on a number of counts, but I will mention two. First, it served to undermine the existing historical narrative. By 1973, Mormonism was deeply entrenched in the belief that its race-based priesthood and temple restrictions were in place from the beginning of the faith, that Joseph Smith began them, and that the restrictions stretched through the heavens and ultimately were of divine origins. Stephen Taggart in 1970 started to chip away at that narrative when he articulated what has come to be called the Missouri thesis, the idea that the priesthood restriction grew out of the Latter-day Saints' troubled sojourn in Missouri. Bush's article went further than that. Bush found no evidence to tie the restriction to Joseph Smith or the founding decades of Mormonism. He located the beginnings of the racial priesthood and temple restrictions in the Great Basin rather than Missouri, and with Brigham Young rather than Joseph Smith. These were enormously significant revisions to the narrative. The second reason Bush's article is so significant is because people read it, and not just the average subscriber to Dialogue, but the LDS hierarchy. In 1999, the Journal of Mormon History published another important article that Bush wrote entitled Writing Mormonism's Negro Doctrine, an Historical Overview, Context, and Reflections. In it, Bush chronicles his experiences writing the original 1973 article and offers evidence of the fact that key members of the LDS hierarchy read his scholarship and that it had an impact on the events culminating in the June 1978 revelation. Let me be clear, I am not claiming a direct cause and effect relationship. There were a variety of forces at play, but Bush's article was one of them. Edward Kimball acknowledged that his father, Spencer W. Kimball, the then leader of the church, had read Bush's article, and it had an impact on his thinking and approach to the priesthood and temple restrictions. Bush's article helped to shape Kimball's thinking before he announced a revelation in June of 1978. So following Bush's article, much of the ensuing historiography was shaped by the questions that the forgetfulness and the internal LDS narrative had created. When did the priesthood and temple restrictions begin? Who started them, and why were they put in place? Questions about a Mormon racial theology, curses, slavery, and abolitionism also animated scholars' approaches to the subfield. So internal LDS historical forgetfulness shaped the approaches that historians and other scholars took in their study of race and Mormonism, and much of the historiography has been thereby focused on the black-white binary in Mormonism. So point number two, simply the power of whiteness. And here I want to then go to a couple of other moments in the historiography of race and Mormonism. In 1981, Noel Bringhurst publishes Saints, Slaves, and Blacks. And in 2003, Armin Moss publishes All Abraham's Children. So when I say that the historiography has failed to engage or grapple with this notion of the power of whiteness in American history and in Mormon history, I want to note that Noel Bringhurst, at least tangentially in his book, touches on notions of whiteness, and Armin Moss, especially as he deals with British Israelism and Anglo-Saxon triumphalism, also addresses notions of whiteness. So I'm not suggesting that it was never touched before, but it is a part of that historiography. For myself, then, in reading whiteness historiography, I came to the conclusion that as a predominantly white church in the United States, Mormons have yet to grapple with the power of whiteness in American history and in Mormon history. With the exceptions that I just mentioned, the historiography has not grappled with this power. In 19th century America, whiteness dominated the social, political, and economic life of the country. Politicians equated being white with citizenship and fitness for self-rule. Very first Congress, 1790, decided qualifications to become a naturalized citizen, and you had to be free and white. It was a socially imagined category which was taken for granted, deemed normal or natural, and functioned as the preferred condition in American history. As a result, sometimes white people like me assume that race is what other people have. White Mormons like me sometimes think race is somehow invisible for white people, and therefore America's racial problems do not impact or affect white people. So, what I think has been missing from the dialogue around diversity and Mormonism is whiteness. I wrote a book that suggests that the Mormon racial story is best understood when we don't take Mormon whiteness as an assumed fact in the 19th century, but understand it as a contested variable. Mormonism was born into an era of fracturing monolithic whiteness in US history, and Mormonism did not escape the impact of that fracturing. So I laid out a racial trajectory that moves from Mormons being perceived as not white enough in the 19th century to too white by the 21st century. And let me just briefly try to tell you what I mean by Mormons being perceived as not white enough. This is just one of a myriad of political cartoons and illustrations that give evidence to the ways in which Mormons are imagined in the 19th century. This is from John Sherwood's The Comic History of the United States, published in 1870, and it's simply titled A Mormon Family Out for a Walk. And you have the enfeebled male out front, and then the long string of wives, and then the seemingly endless string of children. But it's not the number of wives and children that is most striking about this illustration, but it's the interracial nature of the family. You have the imagined black mammy wife here, you have an Asian wife, and you have a Native American or Pacific Islander wife. So as outsiders are imagining in the 19th century, Mormon polygamy is not merely destroying the traditional family, it's destroying the white race. So Mormons are being denigrated and imagined as facilitators of race mixing and destroying the white race, making it unfit for democracy. So that's what I mean when I say that Mormons were perceived as not white enough in the 19th century. The internal response was to move away from blackness in the 19th century toward whiteness. One of the most significant ways that you claim whiteness for yourself in the 19th century is in distance from blackness. So Mormons thus moved away from their own black converts across the course of the 19th century and solidified race-based priesthood and temple restrictions in place by the early 20th century. So successful were Mormons at claiming whiteness for themselves that by the 21st century, Mormons face the exact opposite racial perception, that they are too white. In response, we see today an institutional effort at claiming an international and racially diverse identity for Mormonism. I'm not sure, however, that Mormonism will be successful at claiming that more diverse identity until it learns the lessons of whiteness and starts to teach a racial history that includes those lessons. White Mormons in the pew will have to become cognizant of their ancestors' own fraught relationship with whiteness and adopt a more complex understanding of their own racial history. White Mormons will have to learn to not take their own white ancestors' racial identity for granted, even if those ancestors were native-born Americans or immigrants from Western and Northern Europe, and then take that heightened understanding and use it as a source of empathy toward marginalized groups in the present. Especially at this moment of deep racial tension in the United States, how can a predominantly white saint in a predominantly white church in the United States start seeing black and brown Latter-day Saints and start recognizing them and acknowledging that they might be feeling pain as incident after incident of racial violence plays out across the nation. Following the killing of 9 black people in Charleston in June of 2015, I captured some of the responses on social media from black Latter-day Saints after attending LDS services that Sunday. One person wrote, "In my ward," which is an LDS congregation, "the crickets even did not chirp. With regards to the Charleston 9, it was quieter than an empty building. Even an empty building makes noise when it settles. I find myself in a tight spot. There was a pastor, Elder Blakely. He often preached about a tight spot. Now, over 25 years later, I get it. I'm in it. And it is so tight, I'm struggling to don't know if I'm going to make it through without a shove." Another said, "I flocked to 19th Street Baptist Church and basked in what true worshiping and mourning looks like, because Lord knows I needed it. The junior pastor there spoke of some deep, beautiful truths, leading off the sermon with statistics from Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow. And you already know, leading off with that, he's going in deep. The sanctity of those 9 souls who welcomed that snake as he slithered on into their father's house and deceived them like our Savior was deceived. The entire time, the tears streamed down my face. I sat in what felt like home, refuge. Those truths, those precious truths, all of it, I soaked in. And then I went back to my ward, where the crickets chirped. And I said, nope, they have to be honored, and I made sure to speak." A third said, "So today's lesson is right out of the manual. I'm beginning to feel like church is becoming more robotic. No empathy was shown about the people of Charleston. They say without charity we cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven. Where's the charity, the compassion? I sat through Calvary today and I knew love. I felt love." A fourth said, "You won't get much beyond what's correlated. The word fails to live when it's correlated. It doesn't feel alive. It's hard to feast on stale food. I'm probably going to join y'all at Calvary or Trinity next Sunday and make it home in time to lead music in Relief Society by 3 p.m. As long as white Mormons are secure in their whiteness and believe that race is invisible for white people and is always something, someone else's problems, Mormons will continue to struggle with race and continue to be predominantly a white church in the United States. So the last point then is this gap between the academic scholarship and the LDS curriculum. It's been over 40 years since Lester Bush's article appeared in Dialogue, a journal of Mormon thought. And a good number of scholarly publications have ensued, and yet the way in which the story has been taught on the inside of Mormonism has largely remained stagnant. There have been 2 recent improvements. In 2013, most Latter-day Saints may be unaware that the new 2013 version of the LDS scriptures has a new introductory heading to the 1978 revelation. It offers at least a bit of historical context and officially admits that black men were ordained to the priesthood in the early decades of the church. That information alone is important. It begins the process of recovering the lives of black Mormon pioneers and returning them to their rightful place in LDS history. It also helps Mormons to reconsider the story of a race-based priesthood and temple denial as a move from universal priesthood and temples to segregated priesthood and temples and then back again. The new introduction does suggest that, quote, "the church records offer no clear insights into the origins of this practice," close quote. As a historian, I disagree with that sentiment. Even still, I choose to interpret it as an indication that church records offer no indication that a revelation began the practice or that it was of divine origins. The other then more recent change goes along with what Margaret was mentioning, these gospel topics essays. One was introduced in December 2013 on race and the priesthood, and subsequently language in the introductory page to these race and the priesthood essays also include the notion that these were approved by the First Presidency and the Quorum of the 12 Apostles. And I think probably the most significant paragraph of that race and the priesthood essay is a disavowal paragraph. Today, the church disavows the theories advanced in the past that black skin is a sign of divine disfavor or curse, or that it reflects unrighteous actions in a premortal life, that mixed race marriages are a sin, or that blacks or people of any other race or ethnicity are inferior in any way to anyone else. Church leaders today unequivocally condemn all racism, past and present, in any form. Now, curriculum at BYU and in the LDS Church Institutes are starting to incorporate these gospel topics essays into their curriculum. However, the average Latter-day Saint gets his or her version of LDS history from Sunday school. And 2017, the LDS curriculum goes through a four-year cycle, will be Doctrine and Covenants and Church History. And they will be using, again, the same manual that was written in 1999 for next year's curriculum in Sunday school. And that manual includes, this is lesson 42 from that manual is a screen capture. This is the entire amount of information that is given to a teacher to teach about the 1978 revelation. A paragraph and a couple of bullet points in a lesson that is called Continuing Revelation. So it is ironic that in a lesson on Continuing Revelation, of the examples that the manual uses, only one was canonized and became binding upon the body of the church, the 1978 revelation on the priesthood. It is beyond ironic that the same manual devotes one short paragraph and two bullet points to that revelation. It offers no context and no explanation as to why a revelation extending the priesthood to blacks of African descent was needed in the first place, and says nothing about the fact that the restriction also included a prohibition against black women from attending Mormon temples, as well as black men. In comparison, the other examples in this lesson 42 it uses of continuing revelation are church correlation, with roughly two pages devoted to such topics as the importance of the family, operation of church auxiliaries, preparation of church publications, and home teaching as evidence of correlation's revelatory reach. Publication of new Latter-day Saint editions of the scriptures is another subtopic here as evidence of continuing revelation, a topic that receives nine paragraphs of attention in the manual, and additional quorums of the 70, five paragraphs and three bullet points. It is difficult to imagine how a gospel doctrine teacher might approach this lesson on revelation and possibly focus upon the one canonized revelation in the manual without any additional resources. If the teacher is of the stick-to-approved materials variety, then there really is not much to base a lesson on in the authorized manual. Thus, Mormonism continues to float adrift in a sea of folk beliefs, curses, and racialized readings of the scriptures to its own detriment. I should add in closing that the bulk of my remarks have focused on the black-white binary because Mormonism's racial priesthood and temple restrictions have dominated the Mormon racial story and the historiography. There is a good and growing body of work on Mormon-Indian relations. I devote two chapters to that topic in my book, one chapter to the fracturing of monolithic whiteness in the U.S. and its impact on the racialization of European Mormons, and a chapter on Asian and Mormon conflations. But what are the other ethnicities that are integral to the growing international Mormon family, especially those from Latin America, the Pacific world, and the Philippines, all hotbeds of Mormon growth in the 20th and 21st centuries? Recent scholarship has addressed Mormon racialization of Hawaiians, but much more waits to be done in Latin America and the Philippines, let alone the Pacific world. Here too, whiteness as a variable is crucial to the various stories waiting for scholarly treatment. In short, as scholars move the Mormon racial discourse forward, they should not neglect to situate Mormon views on race from the inside looking out, alongside views from the outside looking in, and pay attention to the ways in which Mormons were both racialized by others and in turn participated in the racialization process themselves. Thank you.
Thank you both.
Yeah, he's kidding.
That's what we're gonna do.
Okay, we have approximately 30 minutes for Q&A, so the same ground rules, of course, apply to the session as has been the case with others, right? Please wait for the microphone. Please state your question clearly and succinctly, and then, to quote Bob Goldberg again, surrender the microphone. So, with that, who'd like to go?
So it seems like one of the interesting ways that, both of the topics you presented on intersect, which was alluded to in, Paul's presentation, is that African American women were not endowed in the temple. Which, you know, prior to the 1978 revelation. So it seems like there's priesthood implications there because it was referred to as a ban on the priesthood. And so I'm just curious, you know, if you could comment on the potential, you know, the scholarship potential for, that as a topic, and if there has been any movement on trying to parse out what the, meaning of that is.
I think there's definitely potential there for talking about priesthood. I don't know of anybody who's written about that, but I think it should definitely be addressed because it seems to imply that the leaders on some level knew that there are priesthood, they know that there are priests in the temple, and that in order for a man to go to the temple, he has to be ordained to the Melchizedek priesthood. A woman doesn't need that, and so it should be true that if that's the case, then a black woman should of African American descent should have been able to go to the temple, but it was not allowed. And so I think it's a topic rife for discussion of, you know, what that means historically. And maybe I can just link that, in fact, with one of the points that Paul made about historical forgetfulness. In fact, I thought all three of your points, Paul, really apply to gender as well as race, that there's a long history in this article I'm writing, a response to the church's essay, in the early 20th century between Relief Society leaders and the 12 apostles about priesthood promises that had been given to them by Joseph Smith, and that really show a nervousness on the part of leaders about the topic and the attempt to really bury the implications. And I think the issue of race, and it's a very astute comment, would be an interesting kind of juxtaposition for teasing out what that meant and kind of the history of leadership's denial of the implications of temple and the priesthood for women.
So I'll just, is that on?
I guess that's not. I don't think it is.
Maybe we'll share.
Yeah.
I'll just add the problem in doing the research, right, is that this plays out most prominently in the historical record. So unfortunately, historians are bound by what's written down, and the sources that I had access to. Jane Manning James is applying for her temple endowments, and the denials never mention priesthood. It's never used as a justification. They only mention the curse of Cain, which is what Brigham Young establishes as the beginning of the denial for priesthood to men of African descent. Never mentioned priesthood in any of the communications with Jane Manning James that survive in the written records that I had access to. And so making the connection becomes difficult vis-a-vis the record that's left behind. I think they're obviously concerned about race mixing. And if you allow black people to get married in the temple, you're opening up the possibility of race mixing. And I think race mixing is a primary concern for Brigham Young as he transitions from an open racial attitude in March of 1847 to a very closed racial attitude that he articulates to the territorial legislature in 1852. So I think there are probably a lot of things at play. Making a priesthood connection is just difficult because the one case we have in the 19th century is Jean Manning James, and they never mention priesthood in rejecting her applications for the endowment.
So my question is for Professor Toscano. I'm interested, so you spoke a lot about women's issues in Mormon history and contemporary Mormon studies. So I'm curious about how gender as a category beyond the male-female binary fits into your future projects.
State your last part again.
Oh, so how do notions of gender beyond just, beyond women's issues or women's questions, womanist theology, how does that become part of the larger sort of gender studies conversation, say especially with the LDS family proclamations talking about how gender is an essential characteristic?
I think it's this is a new area that's becoming really important in Mormon gender studies. It hasn't been a major issue in the past, but in the last 3 or 4 years, I think it's going to be the hot new topic. You know, how do we, you know, can we propose gender fluidity within a Mormon paradigm? Although I do have to say that the proclamation on the family has been critiqued by women, women and Mormon feminists for a long time as putting forth a very rigid view of male and female. So there's been a lot of discussions about trying to undo, you know, those rigid definitions of what maleness is or femaleness is and so forth. And so that's been going on for a long time. But the implications in terms of, you know, other identities that are not, you know, if you're not claiming woman to be a woman or a man, if you're more androgynous, how do you fit into the Mormon paradigm? But I think that's going to be one of the hot areas, I think, for gender studies. That's the direction I see it going when I talk to a lot of people.
Sorry, I snuck the microphone back here. Thank you both for wonderful presentations. They're both thoughtful and very interesting. If I could ask just one question of each. So more specifically to Margaret, I'm wondering, within the context of intersectional feminism, leading off of the last question, but more specifically, how do you understand the concept of motherhood without conflating femininity with motherhood? And how does that sort of, where do you draw the line when you look at a larger cosmology or theology about what it means to be sort of God's children, a sort of Mormon understanding of a parental or familial relationship with the divine, and sort of how does that kind of break down when you think of, if a woman doesn't necessarily have to be a mother, then how do we understand a female God that isn't a heavenly mother? So that was my question for Margaret. And then for Paul, I was just curious, when you talked about how the gospel topics essays are being incorporated in the sort of CES system, but not in Sunday school, do you think that might be in part sort of an effort to talk more to the youth of the church and sort of a little bit of a hesitancy of leaders of the church about approaching older members of the church with this information? And the reason I'm asking that, could that also be part of an effort to bring a lot of youth that are leaving the church through what you might call internet-facilitated faith crises, sort of trying to address that problem? And so the sort of race gospel topics are kind of a way to address that problem, and then the sort of leaders might be thinking, hey, in the future we'll get to the members of the church that are a little bit, been around a little bit longer, and we'll get to Sunday school. Is that maybe a accurate way to think about it, just thoughts about that sort of analysis?
Sure.
So the question really revolves around the issue of embodiment. And you know, as I said briefly in my presentation, the sort of easy way it seems out of the conundrums of motherhood and how that relates to identity or familial relationships is that you say, well, God is beyond all of that. We have that here. And in this life, we should try to promote diversity and accept everyone as a child of God and accept all different kinds of gender and sexuality, if you're a liberal person, right? But then you have two issues. First of all, if you are a believing Mormon, how do you deal with Revelation and what seems to be already in the Mormon scriptures, right? So, I mean, even though Heavenly Mother is not in Mormon scriptures, she's now pretty much been ensconced in terms of orthodoxy, although very little is said. I mean, if you look at the essay, the church essay on Heavenly Mother, there's not much there. And yet, the motherhood thing is there. So how do we deal with that? I don't have an easy answer. I mean, I think maybe one productive way of dealing with this is the Mormon notion of relationship. I think it's section 130, is that it talks about that the same relationships we have here will be in the next life, but they will be accompanied with glory, that somehow they'll be transformed in a way. And so I guess as a theologian, one of the things I ask is, what are the possibilities within this theological structure? You know, how far can we push it and it's still Mormon? How far can we push it and still have something that feels like it's Mormon theology that we could maybe persuade mainstream members with? As a liberal feminist, an intersectionist feminist that wants to be, you know, have more fluid gender, how, as a theologian, do I argue that so that I'm not just so far out that I don't sound Mormon anymore and I might as well just go start my own church, right, where I have it like I want it? So for me, that's the real question. And I mean, I don't have any real clear answers yet, but I think that it's kind of trying to work with the possibilities within the Mormon texts themselves so that you, and that's why I hinted at, I think sort of a polytheism actually is a possibility within Mormonism, or a council of gods that creates many different kinds of subjects and gender positions. But again, how far can you push that and it's still Mormon so that you're not outside of the tradition? That's the challenge.
So in terms of the rollout of the Gospel Topics essays, I think Mormonism as a whole is going through a transition period currently in terms of the way that it tells its own story. Now, I see all kinds of parallels to the transition that U.S. history went through in the 1970s in terms of the way that we tell our master narrative as an American historian, right? So I'm very much attuned to that. And there are all kinds of, you know, difficulties that happened when that took place in American historiography, and, you know, even to the current time, you have the state of Texas that is trying to roll back what they deem as liberal academia way of teaching, you know, Texas history. So Mormonism is going through that transition period, and why is it that these essays are being taught, you know, at BYU in the curriculum, at Institute? My understanding is that at seminary, it can be sort of spotty, but they're being told to address them, and that can vary from district to district and how that's being rolled out, but nonetheless, and there's a major speech given by Eller Ballard that Brian referred to on Wednesday in his talk, which directed seminary and institute teachers to know these essays like the back of their hand. So, you know, I think there is concern about the rising generation, and so they are addressing that issue first. Is there something deliberate going on in terms of hiding this from the older generation? I'm not convinced that that's the case. I don't know the full story as to why the Sunday school curriculum is going with the same manual. 8 years ago, I registered a complaint about the manual. I thought there would be no way that 4 years from then they would still have the same manual, and here we are 8 years later and it's the same manual. My understanding is that they are going to attempt to direct most people to the online version of the manual where they will have supplementary material. I don't know what that's going to look like. And then in an international church in a lot of rural and impoverished areas that might not have access to the internet, right, you're really not ensuring that everyone has access to those electronic materials, those supplementary electronic materials. I was told that that was the stopgap measure for next year, was to have things like Joseph Smith papers, revelations in context, additional materials made electronically available for the curriculum for next year. What that will mean for the lesson material for the continuing revelation lesson is yet to be seen. So I don't know, but for whatever reason, they didn't have a new curriculum for next year, church history and doctrine and covenant. So the manual itself in some instances will not be in tune with the gospel topics essays is the irony for the curriculum for next year.
I have the mic. I'd like to follow up this, the point about embodiment. So there are two kind of visual images which I have. One is a brand new book that has just come out. It's a children's book on the heavenly parent slash heavenly mother. And the cover of the book is a couple, a white couple, where the woman is obviously pregnant. And there are all these little dots that eventually get made into people. And this is a book which is published by Deseret Books. So I think it's really an important visualization of this that I've never seen before, and that I think is really important. And then the second is that the art, of course, of Jesus always portrays Jesus as white. And I just went and had my eyes done today, and in my doctor's office, there's the Mormon Jesus with a little black child. So the contrast between the white Jesus and the black child is quite sharp. And of course, if you look at the visions are quite of Joseph Smith. They're quite clear that Joseph Smith was aware of eye color and skin color. And he made it very clear that this was the color of the divine. And so I'm just wondering theologically, how you get around, and also in terms of gender, both in gender and in terms of race, mm-hmm. how do you get around this embodiment in the literalness that seems to be so key in both in Mormon theology, but also in popular representation of Mormonism?
It's hard. I mean, you don't. I mean, and of course, it's interesting that it's not simply in Mormonism, it's also in Christianity. If you have the notion of... Well, you have... It's what? Go say that again.
The embodiment.
It's not embodied. I mean, or other Christians would just say God doesn't have a body.
No, I know. But you have depictions of Jesus as an historical figure. That's kind of my point. But I know that, believe me, I know the theological arguments that once he goes into the next life, that, you know, somehow it's a transformation and so forth. No, I totally agree with you that Mormonism has the embodiment problem more than any other religion. And especially because it emphasizes the literal so much. So I really do not have an answer for how you get around that other than multiplicity, which was my answer to the other question, right? That you can't, if you're committed to embodiment and committed to the fact that, and even if you say, well, gender is eternal, I didn't feel like I answered your question completely. You could say, well, if gender is eternal, does that mean that we always have to have the same gender? You know, if motherhood is a part of, you know, if motherhood is one attribute of femaleness, could you be a female without having motherhood? But again, I'm getting into a really pushing it in a way that Orthodox Mormons don't, and the children's book is the perfect illustration of that. We finally have a visualization of Heavenly Mother, and she doesn't break the stereotypes, she reinforces them. And so it's a real problem. I mean, again, the only answer I can come up with within Mormon theology is multiplicity. that you have to have multiple images, multiple gods, multiple ways of seeing gender and God and sex. But I'm not sure how many people I'm going to persuade. It's, you know, the fact that they do this children's book. It's a real problem. It really is. And I guess, you know, I mean, from what, when I talk to people, they really say, well, Mormonism has got to get rid of that literalness, right? We've got to move into kind of a more liberal, you know, beyond gender. It's the only way that we can deal with this. And maybe that's true. I mean, I'm trying to argue for multiplicity, but maybe ultimately you have to move in the other direction.
So in terms of the racial aspect of your question, I guess I'm just aware of the problems that it creates more than I am aware of any sort of solution. But for example, Black Latter-day Saints being told by White Latter-day Saints, won't it be really wonderful in the resurrection that you will get a white body, right? And you know, we wonder why Black Latter-day Saints leave. Those are the kind of things that White Latter-day Saints say to them, so that you're absolutely right, the notion of the divine is white in Mormonism, and the assumption then is that that's normal, that's the whiteness problem that I talked about. And so those are the kind of things, sure, well-intentioned Mormons are saying to their Black brothers and sisters, right? And Black Latter-day Saints are saying, I'm always going to be Black. And it also creates the problem in terms of representation, right? So Black Latter-day Saints going to temples, the imagery in Latter-day Saint temples. There's now a Black woman kneeling in prayer that has become a part of temple paintings, right, pictures, but a single representation. And notions of the afterlife never include Black angels, never include some sort of idea of Black or any sort of other racial identity in the afterlife. And so Black Latter-day Saints say, we are imagined out of our theology. We don't exist. We have been erased, or we never were there. You know, those are the problems that it creates, absolutely.
Let me just add one little thing here. I think it's interesting that on the one hand, the notion of eternal embodiment, as we've just been talking, creates enormous problems. And yet there's also the flip side, there's something appealing about it, in the sense of back to relationships and to, well, you would know this, Colleen, about how we picture heaven, right? The notion that something appealing is that in the next life, I will be able to continue, not just continue relationships, but make up for what I lost here. So I'm thinking about my own sister who died with eight young children. She died of breast cancer. And for her, the notion and that she, in the next life, and she was a very firm believer, that she would be able to be with those children again, you know, that's very comforting. That's a real powerful part of embodiment. It's like we're not just going to be floating out there, but somehow these same relationships will matter. And the loss that I had here when I had to die so young of cancer, somehow that will be made up to me. So that's, you know, the positive side. And I don't know how you reconcile the really negative with what is actually very, you know, positive from a religious experiential point of view.
About that intersectionality.
It's that too.
Intersectionality. do you see any... Personally, I feel one of the most powerful aspects of our tradition is that it used to be that symbolic learning, figurative learning was very important, and we've stepped away from that and lost a lot of that, at least in the general culture of Mormonism. We've gone so literal that gender is literal and it's binary and that it has to look this way. Do you see any way or any direction in the conversation as we're looking at multiple ways of seeing something, that this multiplying and increasing that seems to be so crucial to our feeling of what our purpose is and what God does, it can be stepped away from some requirement of it only happening through birth canal, but more along the lines of the multiplying and the replenishing being through relationships rather than a literal physical birth, that somehow our heavenly parents have to be tied up with the literal pregnancy and literal birth canal birth, but more along the lines of the power of our parents to have influence is in the relationship, is in the inspiration, is in what we learn from that example. Because I think symbolically and figuratively learning, that's where it all points to. But that's just, again, that's me. That's how I can interpret it in a way that spreads across all non-binary situations, all intersectionality, is that the relationships, the power that we have in there. Do you see any movement to returning to that type of thing? Because I also see that in a lot of Joseph Smith's teachings.
I don't know. How do we move away from this sort of strict literalism? I don't see much movement, but maybe we should go on to the next question. But I think it's a really good point that you've made. You know, really, it comes down to that. How do we get away from just this really narrow-minded literalism in terms of how we interpret doctrine and ideas?
Yeah, quick question. Twice a year, members of the church sustain the general authorities as prophets, seers, and revelators. And if I recall, Wilford Woodruff, president of the church, famously said that the Lord would never allow the president of the church to lead the people astray. And then we think of the priesthood ban and what now appears to be a colossal mistake. How do we rationalize those two things, revelation and big mistakes?
Sure. Yeah. So I think the priesthood and temple restrictions automatically raise that question for a lot of people, and the race and the priesthood essay raise that question for a lot of people, and so those are the theological ramifications. The race and the priesthood essay doesn't come out and say that it was a mistake. People can infer that. People can infer that it was sort of the cultural milieu that was incorporated into Mormonism and then sort of became entrenched over time. So you're referring to Wilford Woodruff, and that's where most people go with the notion that Woodruff is promising the saints that the Lord would not allow the prophet to lead the saints astray. What I see as a historian is that Woodruff is going around in 1890 dealing with the manifesto which he has issued and is claiming a revelation, and you have Latter-day Saints who are saying we've sacrificed so much for polygamy and now you're saying to give it up. And Woodruff's response is, the Lord's not going to give me a revelation that will lead the church astray. What gets truncated in Mormon culture is that revelation part. The Lord's not going to let the prophet lead me astray. And it gets to questions of prophetic fallibility, right? In Woodruff's context, he's saying the Lord's not going to give me a revelation that would lead the church astray. I don't think he's saying that anything a prophet ever says is infallible, right? It's a really important distinction, but as it plays out and gets truncated across the course of the 20th century as somehow a written guarantee, then it creates that theological problem. So that for the race and the priesthood, I can see no claim at revelation even, or no evidence for revelation for its beginnings. And yet it gets entrenched over time, and it implicates a variety of LDS leaders in that entrenchment process. It takes on a life of its own. So that's how I see those two things operating, right? I think Latter-day Saints need to sort of step away from the notion of a micromanager God, that every finger lift is directed by God. One of the fundamental tenets in Mormon theology is just simply agency. And God doesn't revoke a prophet's agency when he makes him a prophet. And if a prophet has agency, a prophet can make mistakes. So agency is always sort of the bottom line or baseline, I guess, in Mormon theology. And prophets have agency.
This is kind of a basic question, but I'm just curious what the history is of women's access to the temple and whether that had to do with marriage or not. And if there was, at some point, there's in the back of my mind some kind of recollection that women only went to the temple when their husband gave permission or that they were going to be married, or maybe I'm completely mistaken.
I'm not sure that I can give you all the history of how that works, but certainly there is a traditional pattern of women going to the temple when before they get married. But there are a few exceptions to that. There's always been the, and I don't know if I should say always, maybe you know, Paul, you're the historian, I'm not, but before a woman goes on a mission, she would go to the temple and get her endowments. So while in general women have gone to the temple to get their endowments before they get married, and therefore sort of traditionally or culturally there's this association between marriage and the endowment ceremony, but it doesn't have to be in terms of the ceremony itself. And there with women who are going on missions, going through the temple, through the endowment, because in the temple, there is a ceremony of the endowment, which was this long ritual, and I'm not gonna go into it here, but the marriage ceremony is separate. However, you have to be endowed before you can be married, but you can have the endowment without getting married, and that theologically and ritually, those have actually been separate. I think it's just a sort of a tradition that has built up that women, unless you were going on a mission, you didn't get your endowments until you got married. Do you think it's changed now?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I got my endowments in 1971, and I wasn't going on a mission, and I wasn't getting married. I just went and asked for them. So even back then, you know, that was a real possibility. It's just that most women didn't. Most women were either going on a mission or you were getting married. But symbolically and ritually and theologically, really the two are not connected. And there's no official taboo. And I don't think there ever has been. Do you think any of you? I don't think there has been.
So I'll just add, going back to the Nauvoo temple records, so single women were given their endowment from the get-go, from the Nauvoo temple record. So I know because I just looked up a single white Latter-day Saint who ended up marrying a black Latter-day Saint, and some had suggested they were sealed in Nauvoo. I found her in the endowment record, not him, and no indication that there was ever a sealing that took place, but she received her endowment as a single Latter-day Saint.
And I've seen those records too. There are a number of people, both men and women, who received endowments as single individuals. Actually, also people who received the second anointings as singles as well. So, no, there's no taboo or rule about that.
Sadly, we're out of time. Before we give our panelists a round of applause, I want to call your attention to the final panel, which will be on Thursday, December 8th. That will be on the LDS Church and the Academic Study of Mormonism, which will feature Elder Marlin Jensen, former church historian, General Authority Emeritus, and other scholars from the institutional church to report on and analyze and reflect on how the institution is engaging in all of the scholarship that we've been learning about and talking about this semester. So we hope to see you then. In the meantime, please have a happy holiday, and please join me in thanking Margaret and Paul.